Today is Tuesday, February the 26th, 2013. And my name is David Favor, by the way, and I was talking with Michael Abedin, who is the editor and publisher of Austin All Natural magazine. Actually, Austin, Houston, and San Antonio now. So, you know, if you have some sort of business in those three cities, or you're looking to access the sort of high vibrational alternative health, alternative thinking demographic or psychographic meaning how people think, collection of people in Austin, Houston, San Antonio, Austin All Natural is definitely the magazine to advertise in. Anyway, that was a unsolicited pitch for Austin All Natural. All right, pitch mode off. Anyway, I was talking with Austin All Natural publisher Michael Abedin, and I was talking with him about, I just randomly opened one issue of his magazine, which this is the February 2013 issue. And I just opened it, and I opened it to page 18 and 19, and I looked at the ads and articles here. And my first thought was, you know, gee whiz, Michael, if your clientele, which is placing ads and writing articles for your magazine, were, you know, they continued to do exactly what they were doing in Austin All Natural, which is, you know, highly lucrative if it's done correctly. I'm looking at most of these ads and they are done incorrectly. If they're done correctly, this is a gold mine for local businesses. Now, a much bigger gold mine, though, is to take all this information and to reach a larger market. And I'll explain how to do that in a minute. It's pretty simple, you know, metrics. If you think about, like I'm looking here, the first ad on page 18 is Bart Sharp, which I know, which is doing anger release therapy. And so, you know, Bart has his consulting business here, and he sees clients, and he charges, you know, more than likely an hourly consulting fee. And I have no idea what that is. It's probably, you know, between $50 and $500 an hour, though. I would guess, you know, on average, this type of consulting is probably in the $150 an hour range. So, you know, simple numbers. If he can see, you know, 20 people a week times $150 an hour, let's see what that is. 20 times 150 is $3,000 a week, which, you know, that's a fairly acceptable amount of money. Now, on the other hand, though, if you take that $3,000 a week and divide it by, we'll say, $2, if he sold 1,500 copies of Kindle books times $2 a week, it's the same $3,000 a week, except it's exactly zero time involved. For the $3,000 a week that he makes doing consulting, he's got to invest 20 hours of his time. And, you know, if we can make the same thing on Kindle by selling 1,500 copies at a $2 a payout price point, which we'll talk about in a minute. Here's the benefit, though. If Bart would like to go to $6,000 a week, that means he now has to work 40 hours. He is going to be one tired puppy working 40 hours. If he'd like to double it again to go from $6,000 to $12,000 a week, unfortunately, he's at 80 hours a week now. Whereas in Amazon, let's take the way that you would do this on Amazon. Then I'll tell you how I'd convert Bart's business here as a coach or consultant into an Amazon type of format. Is, let's say that you've got a book that pays you $2 a sale on Amazon, and like I've got a database of all the radio shows in the country. There's only about 2,300 to 2,400 of those radio shows that reach 100,000 people an hour. Here's a simple question for Bart. Is it more effective for you to do a one-on-one consulting session with a person for an hour and get $150, Or is it more effective to go on a radio show for 15 minutes? And oh, by the way, did I mention that these 2,300 to 2,500 radio shows, these are the radio shows in the country that reach over 100,000 people per hour? Now, imagine if you're having a 10 or 15 minute conversation with a radio show host about, anger release therapy, and you had that conversation with 100,000 people. Well, let's do a little simple math. 100,000. It's pretty simple math. If you talk to 100,000 people and 1% of those people go to Amazon to buy your book, you just made $2,000 for 15 minutes of interview time. So simple, 2,000 times 4, that would be $8,000 an hour. So is there a difference between $8,000 an hour and $150 an hour? Well. To me, I personally would rather have the $8,000 an hour, and then if I'd like to do an hour worth of consulting with somebody, that's great. I can do it for fun. I can do it for free. I can do it for $150 an hour, leave it there. I can do it for $20 an hour. I can do it for $1,000 an hour. If I've got, $8,000 coming in for an hour's worth of radio interview or more, because for me, when I go on a radio interview, I may get a hit rate of 30 to 40% a lot of times. Well, that's a lot of cash coming out of Amazon. So the question becomes then, you've got the metrics in mind. The big difference would be, you do an hour of work and make $150, or you do an hour of work and make $8,000. Pretty simple metrics. Now the question is, how do you take a consulting business like this and turn it into a Kindle funnel? Well, here's the way I would do it. This is really very, very old school marketing. Any chief marketing evangelist that you hire will probably do this, a CME. I say evangelist instead of an officer, because a marketing officer you don't want to hire. A marketing evangelist you do like to hire. A marketing evangelist is excited about what your business is to the point where they can naturally share that with people and excite other people, which is going to generate a whole whale of a lot more sales than if you've got a marketing officer that's sitting around an office, figuring out how to do paid advertising. A marketing evangelist would go, for example, and speak on stage or do joint venture marketing with people, like other people in a similar space to anger release therapy or technologies, to provide information products going out to large numbers of people. In other words, the point about a marketing evangelist over an officer is that they think outside the box and they know about how to use current technologies to leverage huge numbers of people. Now, the challenge though is that, Bart, for him to capitalize on this, he's got to have a marketing churn, I'll call it, that can handle a huge number of people. A marketing churn is like if you put, I grew up on a farm in rural Oklahoma, and so, if you'd like to make cream or butter, you put milk in a churn and you churn the churn up and down, and the plunger goes up and down, and after a while, the milk separates into different layers, and you get a butter layer, you get a cream layer. The point is that in marketing, if you have a marketing churn that continually agitates, which means causes your client base to take some sort of action, is your client base will naturally stripe itself or organize itself into all these layers of different layers of butter and cream and cheese and whatever. That's the whole function of a churn. So in Bart's case, here's how I'd use the old chiropractor model. So the old chiropractor model is that any chiropractor coming out of school can easily make, five figures of income a month and scale it up to six figures of income, the low to mid six figures a year by just seeing clients on their own and having somebody work the front desk. Now, if that chiropractor would like to go up to seven figures, there are two ways to do that. They can either create a a type of facility where they create a whole chain of offices where they manage a bunch of people. That means managing a bunch of minimum wage people working the desk, managing a bunch of prima donna chiropractors, which I, you know, that just sounds like a root canal to me. The other way, and most of the chiropractors I know that are making 7 or 8 figures a month, they have no offices and they see no clients. So the question becomes, how do you run a one-on-one, face-to-face market or a client or consulting practice to a given market around a given topic? And how do you do that in such a way where you have no office, you see no people, and you're able to reach thousands of people a day, potentially, automatically? That's the whole idea of a marketing churn. So here's how you do that. And I think I'll give you an example out of our business. I have a superfood. One of my businesses is a superfood business, and I found this out just by accident. It was not that I'm all that smart. Back in around 2007, I guess it was, I was doing, along with my wife, about 100 client practice hours every week. I was doing probably 80% of those hours. She was doing 20%. That was face-to-face clients, email consultations, phone conversations. Anyway, the bottom line was we were doing a lot of work, making a pretty good chunk of money. The challenge was we're working 100 hours a week, and I, you know, my conversation with myself was, gee whiz, I like the money, and I'd like to double it. Problem is, that's 200 hours a week, and there's only 168. So I had to really give some consideration to how do I double the amount of income without doubling my hours. So what I did was I took a look at the common conversations I had in my client intake procedure. And this is how a lot of chiropractors and counselors and energy workers, people that even massage therapists can do the same thing, is you take your client intake procedure and you turn that into a product. So here's what I did. Is I created, and you can go look at the, there's an old version online right now at radicalhealth.com/guide. I took all of our client intake information, which was about 2 hours of information that I typically went through with clients. And what I told clients was this: if you go through this step-by-step guide, I will give you free consulting, any number of hours of free consulting you like. But here's the requirement. You have to go through the step-by-step guide. You have to implement every step for 3 to 4 months, because that's the only way you're going to get the, you know, 99% of your questions answered, because people primarily get their questions answered through direct experience much better than just reading about something or going and randomly listening to somebody. So the bottom line was that if a person actually went through that step-by-step guide for, you know, 3 to 4 months implementing every steps, they would invest probably over $2,000 with our company. And that wouldn't be an additional $2,000 that came out of pocket. It was just reallocating or redirecting their grocery budget to invest in high-quality raw foods and superfoods instead of processed, cooked, and animal foods that they were eating that were making them sick. And so that was the way that I came up with converting our client intake procedure into a monetizing action, which got me out of the way. Now here's what happened. You remember that 100 client hours a week? What happened in a 30-day period is our client hours went from 100 a week to 1 a week, and our income went up 300% in a 30-day period. I got to that end of that 30-day period and I thought, holy moly. So that told me something very important, and this is the whole point of this, is that the only limiting factor in your business is you. If you have to have a face-to-face interaction with a client to generate a sale, then your entire business is limited by you. Unless you can come up with 10 or 20 or 50 or 100 of you, you know, you're limited by the number of hours you can, you know, easily work within a given number of days or weeks or months. So for me, what I found was rolling up this all this client intake information into a step-by-step guide that empowered my clients to take action on their own. And what I had thought erroneously, in other words, it was an error on my part, is I thought that I had to be a part of my client intake procedure. I thought I was so important that only I could do my job, and I was wrong. I unfortunately gave my clients two consideration to just how amazingly intelligent and proactive they were. I thought that I had to be involved with my business, and that was wrong thinking on my part. So now I know that my job right now is to produce content to share how I do what I do instead of doing what I do. So here's a really important takeaway at this point is in your business, whatever you do, whether you're doing it now or it's a new business you're going to create, is you will always be paid more, your income will be considerably more, showing people how to do what you do instead of doing what you do. In other words, right now, Bart is doing one-on-one consultations with people about how to release their anger. I used to do one-on-one consultations with people about how to upgrade their health. Now, I do that all by way of the physical products we have and the content we have online. In Bart's case, the simple way that he can change his marketing funnel is he either writes a Kindle book or he hires somebody to write it for him. And usually, like for me, if I'm hired to write a Kindle book for somebody, that's going to cost several thousand dollars. It'll be a fraction of what it would cost to put an ad in a magazine. It's still going to be an investment. And I'll take charge of driving traffic to that Kindle book inside of Amazon, so it keeps it high on the bestsellers list, so I get paid. In other words, I keep all the income from that, and Bart keeps all the income that comes to him on the back end, which will probably be hundreds of times more than the Kindle book. So here's the way that works, is when you place a Kindle book in Amazon, and I won't go through all the details, but in general, you'll make between $2 to $7 a sale. And inside that book, though, that book has to be written in such a way to drive traffic to Bart Chart's website. Now, once a person gets to that website, then another facility has to be in place to convert that traffic into a higher dollar sale. So, for example, in my Radical Health business, I'm changing that step-by-step guide into a Kindle book, so that'll become a front end. And then the back end on my website will be physical products. In other words, things like the products we sell, like vanilla agave and chocolate bliss and fiesta mole and hemp seeds and golden flax seeds and dulse and enzymes and probiotics, things like that. In Bart's case, what I would do is I would have a, how to do your own anger release therapy, you know, the at-home, whatever, some sort of at-home study course or construction kit or whatever the name of that is. It's basically the common information that Bart covers with his incoming clients, and instead of covering that information with him, that goes into a course that sells for $27 or $47 or $97 that a person buys. They have to go through that course before they even get to a point where they are able to contact Bart about consulting. And at that point, he may charge for consulting to limit the number of people that come to him, or he may find that so few people actually complete that course that he can offer free consulting, which is even more interesting. That's the model we use at Radical Health, is you go through our guide and you get unlimited lifetime free consulting. So that's the general step-by-step, walkthrough. And that can be applied to anybody. I'm looking, so this is Austin All Natural, February 13, page 18 and 19. So we talked about Bart Sharp's business model. The next ad on this page is somebody, David Shane Shelton, doing labyrinths, contemplative paths, and sacred spaces. So the business model for him is easy. You do a Kindle book about how to create your own labyrinths, contemplative spaces, and sacred spaces. And you In your book, you give a set of plans. You give all the sources of materials where people can go to get their materials to do it themselves. And then you sell back-end consulting services of, you know, I'll come and do this for you if you like. And then maybe you also create a business to actually provide the raw materials. Like maybe there's some special fountains or pumps that run fountains to create water ecosystems. You know, I just know how the guy does what he does. It makes no difference. You start with a book that sells, that generates income. So what that does is it replaces enough of your income that now you have extra free bandwidth, that you're no longer doing work, that you can figure out what to do next to generate higher service and value for your clients, which generates more income. The next person on here, oh, the other thing about the labyrinths, contemplative spaces, and sacred spaces that actually applies to the next ad here too. For David, what I would do is additionally to a Kindle book of showing like a how-to book, I would create a coffee table book that had really beautiful pictures. It's like a portfolio of different contemplative spaces, some of which maybe he's done, maybe some others that other people have done. Anyway, it's a coffee table book, which means that it's published as a Kindle book and also as what's called a Create Space book, which is Amazon's physical publishing arm, so that maybe this book sells for $200. And when they print it out, maybe it's, you know, 100 pages and it's a big, like, maybe 11 by 14 book of, or maybe a square book of like a 12 inch square book, where when they lay it out, it's 12 by 24 inch. And, you know, each one of the page layouts, a double page layout, has a picture of a contemplative space. So the next article on here is this Leslie Kell person that's a photographer, and I've seen some of Leslie's work, and you know, it's a phenomenal that's phenomenal work. And I guess Leslie's a woman. I'm going to pretend this is a woman. So, you know, she does fantastic work. And so let's see, archival of print and custom sets. So she sells archivals of prints. So the whole point of Leslie's business is she's already got a back end. She's selling prints. So the whole challenge with her is the more traffic that comes to her site to buy prints, the higher her income is. And so simple thing for her, she does the same thing as David Shane Shelton did with the ad above. What Leslie does is she does a book, a how-to book about, you know, how to take the picture she takes. All the gear, all the lighting, everything about how-to. And then she sells a coffee table book that is, you know, all like a collection of her prints. And then the back end is, if you know, if you'd like a bigger print, or maybe something like a Cyberchrome print, which is a particular sort of HDR process that really is, you know, makes the prints really pop. I mean, they're really elegant. And maybe she sells different sizes, like a, you know, like a 12 by 24. Maybe she sells one that's like, you know, 4 feet by 8 feet, that's a wall hanging, and each one of these prints has a specific price point. And if, you know, if one print is 10 grand, I mean, you know, how many of those do you have to sell a month before you're excited? Let's see what else is on this page. So Bart's got an article about looking for the right relationship, become the most interesting person in the world. You know, maybe that turns into a, you know, if you're working with somebody like me or another Kindle publisher that's smart, maybe this article turns into either a standalone book, which the way I would do that or with my clients is I go and have like an hour-long interview and I extract enough information from those people to create the equivalent of a 30 to 60 page 6x9 book. Or if it's a shorter amount of material, then maybe this goes into a multi-authored book all about you know, the creating right relationships. And Bart happens to be one of the contributing authors. I would still write that as the publisher. He would just get the byline as the author. And then on page 19, there's a whole page ad by somebody named Otan, Patrick Ford, maybe is the way you say that, called Unwavering Heart. So this is perfect. This is a Kindle book. or it's a physical book, and so all this guy's got to do is drive traffic to this book. So in his case, you know, I would just make sure this is a Kindle book, and you know, price it at the in between the $2.99 and $9.99 price point, so that it generates a 70% commission on Amazon. You know, if you price a book below $2.99 or above $9.99, then you only get paid 30%. I'd also sign the exclusivity contract for the e-publishing rights for Amazon only, because Amazon is responsible for someplace between 80 to 90% of all sales for electronically downloaded books. And it's way better to sign an exclusivity contract with Amazon, which gives you a 70% commission, than to say, no, I'm going to publish on iBooks and for Barnes & Noble for Nook reading devices. So you'll reach maybe 1% or 2% more people, but your payout goes to 30% then. It's way more economical, or it's, it makes far more financial sense to publish only on Amazon. So let's just, I'm going to flip over here on this book to page 16 and 17 just to do a couple more really quick. Nature's Pure Organics is the first one I see here on page 16. Bloodroot Black Salve. If you have cancer, this may be the answer. So first off, eventually the FDA is going to come and throw this guy in jail because he doesn't understand the proper way to word his ads. This ad's in violation of FDA guidelines because you can't say anything is an answer to cancer. That's just, no. People have found that out that have tried to do things like this. So, you know, what this guy might do, here's what I would do is if I was selling Black Salve, which is highly effective for cancer, is I would change this up. I wouldn't use the term Black Salve. I would change it up to Bloodroot Preparations, for example. Now, the FDA says that you can use Bloodroot for tooth preparation. So I would change my Black Salve into Bloodroot toothpaste and get rid of all the stuff about cancer, and publish an ebook about Bloodroot toothpaste. And I might sell Bloodroot toothpaste. I could probably do that without getting crosswise with the FDA. And then to talk about Black Salve as a cancer treatment, I would go online and create a bunch of pseudo identities that, let's see what this guy's name is. Does it say? No, we'll say the guy's name is Jack. So Jack's got Bloodroot Black Salve. So what Jack ought to do is go and create a bunch of pseudonyms or pseudo profiles and go and post on cancer forums and cancer websites. If you know, I probably wouldn't do audio interviews because that could probably be tracked back to me. Anyway, the point is, if you have the equivalent of a pen name, which you're publishing under, you know, a dozen or two dozen different pen names about how much Black Salve has, you know, healed all your cancer and all your friends' cancer and all your relatives' cancer, and it's the best thing since sliced bread, then that's fine. You can write these random articles and say, oh, yeah, you ought to get this book on Kindle that talks about Bloodroot toothpaste, and just to let you know, you can actually use this Bloodroot toothpaste. Just put it on your, you know, use it topically or swallow it, and it does the same thing as Black Salve, and that way you can promote your Black Salve without getting thrown in jail or having your bank accounts attached, which, by the way, the first step the FDA will do is when they catch you, they'll send you a cease and desist letter. So all you have to do is you can pretty much do whatever you like. Like, you could talk about if you've got cancer, this may be the answer all day long until you get the first cease and desist letter. And then you better switch over to selling Bloodroot toothpaste. And if you ignore that cease and desist letter, what they'll do is they'll just go attach your bank account and they'll just, you know, take your money. And that will be a great inspiration for you to do something different. That's typically the way that works. And if you keep ignoring them, then they'll throw you in jail. Let's see, the next one here on page 16 is Herbs and Things. So they're talking about Young Living oil products. I probably wouldn't talk about Young Living because that's somebody else's brand. What I would do as Herbs and Things is I would create my own label of herbal preparations. Like I would go and look, like, you know, so, I mean, they probably sell 300 or 400 different items. I would go into the accounting information for this business. If they hired me as a CME, the chief marketing evangelist, I'd go find their top 10 or 20 products. I would look for the top products that were responsible for probably 80% of their revenue. And I would take those top products and have those made under my own label, under the herbs and things label. And then I would put those products in Amazon so that people in the Amazon product ecosystem could buy them. And then I would publish monograms about each one of the herbs. So that's one book. Like, say, echinacea, we'll just take one random herb. So echinacea, I would do a book about echinacea, just a small 10-page book, sell it for maybe $2.99 or maybe a 20-page book, and it's one section is all about echinacea, the history, the uses, the sources, the natural sources, other synergistic herbs you can mix it with, protocols and procedures for using it as a prophylactic for keeping from, you know, getting infections or colds or whatever, however you chose to do that. And then also another section of how to use it once you have a sinus infection or some sort of immunological situation that you'd like to use echinacea with. And I would do that for every herb. Like if I've got 10 products that were responsible for 80% of my revenue, I'd take and write a book like that for every single herbal ingredient and then reference the product inside that book so that the book drove traffic to sell the physical product. All right, next one here is Geo Growers. So this is a great example. We make dirt. So here's a company that makes organic dirt. So how do you take a local business that makes dirt and have a global income? Now that's simple. You tell people how to make dirt. And you walk through the entire composting process. And the back end for this business then is to sell all the gear. You know, you have your own Geo Growers monogrammed or branded composters and, I don't know, shovels and soil turners or whatever gizmo you can come up with. Also, you can sell salt preparations to add to your, which would are mineral preparations to add to the soil to increase the bioavailability and bioactivity of the soil. Also, strains of bacteria to inoculate soil with to build up the soil faster. And you keep running this front end business until the back end business dwarfs that front-end business, and then you can make a choice whether you keep that business or sell it, and you keep the back end and keep making all the high income. Let's see, the article on this page is Alkaline Ionized Water by Gary Hanna. Okay, so Gary Hanna is probably the guy that's running this Nature's Pure Organics Bloodroot Black Salve thing. By the way, I suggest you go to the Austin All Natural site and download a copy of this issue 81, the February 13 issue, so you can see what I'm talking about here. So he's writing an article about ionized water, and the purpose of this article is to drive people back to another product he's selling on his site, which are Enagic or Kangen water machines. And so, you know, this article is works the same as the article that Bart wrote. It could turn into a standalone book. It could also turn into a part of a multi-authored book. So now we'll go over to page 17 here. And the first ad here is kind of a pink ad up in the top right-hand corner. Has no name on it. Let's see. It says, "Why do I feel sick so often? Get your answers at foodpowers.com. Save 10% using the code AAN for Austin All Natural." Now, this is actually a pretty decent ad. It's simple. So a person, you know, reads this, "Why do I feel sick so often?" So if you, you know, if a person's in continual discomfort, they automatically say, "Yeah, why do I feel bad all the time?" Well, it's to get your answers at foodpowers.com. That's going to be a great motivator to go to foodpowers.com. Oh, I see over The article on this page is written by Nerissa Odin, which is Joe Vitale's partner, I believe. And I believe this is probably the person that wrote this article, so we'll pretend Nerissa is the author of this article. So I'm guessing on foodpowers.com there's all sorts of content. In fact, I'm just going to pull up this site here, foodpowers.com. And in fact, I could do something even more interesting. I could go into, I'm going to go into Google and I'm going to type in the syntax site:foodpowers.com to see how many articles are written there. So there are 135 separate pages, and you know, maybe 10 or 12 of those are links about contact and resource guides or whatever. So we'll say there's at least probably 100 articles on this site that are free articles. And so I choose to know how many, let's just look at this. So I'm looking at one of these articles here, and so she's trying to monetize this site by, I'm not even sure how she's trying to monetize it. It doesn't really make a lot of sense to me. This is, that's a link to something that's a non-article. Let's see. Heal Graves' disease. Here's a good one. So it looks like there's a bunch of articles on here that are... Oh, okay. So here's a good one. So here's an example of Food Powers. Here's a great back end. foodpowers.com/heather_carty.html. Heal Graves' disease. Remove hidden food allergies. Graves' disease is... What is that? Either eyes or... Let's see. Hashimoto's is thyroid. So Graves is... autoimmune dysfunction of eye tissue, which is really bad because eye tissue is externalized brain tissue. So really your eyes are part of your brain. So if you got Graves in your eyes, that means that you probably got it either pre-stage Graves in your brain, which is brain tumors, or it's, you know, currently you're building tumorous material in your brain, neither of which is useful. So, you know, if you get diagnosed with Graves, you better find somebody like myself or maybe somebody here who can fix that in a few days. That's usually how long it takes for us to fix Graves in our client practice. So anyway, I'm looking here at this page. So it looks like that Nerissa is interviewing this person, Heather Carter, and there is part one and part two. So, okay, so here's another thing. So she's got two audios here. Nerissa's published two articles that are 15 minute, or two audio recordings that are probably interviews that are 15 minutes long. So that's 30 minutes. That's the equivalent of, at the speed most people read or talk, that's probably about 15 to 20 pages of a 6x9 book at a 12 to 14 point font. So this material right here, she could send this material over to somebody on Fiverr.com. I get my transcriptions done for 15 to 20 minutes, transcriptions for $5. So this is going to cost her $10 to transcribe this 30-minute conversation, and then turn it over to somebody to turn it into a Kindle book, which is, probably the whole process is probably 1 to 2 days to get this turned into a Kindle book. And so Nerissa could have a whole Kindle book about healing Graves' disease that could be generating income for her. Or if she works with a publisher like me that keeps all the Kindle income, then that publisher would write that book so that it drove people to Nerissa's website to either generate additional interviews with other experts or to sell some sort of product or service or course, which is also, you know, if we go back to Bart Sharp's thing, we talked briefly about a course. If you can create an ebook, or you can take the content of an ebook and turn it into a set of videos and audios with worksheets and call it a course. So an ebook is, you know, a price point of a few dollars, and a course is a price point of a few hundred dollars. So how you arrange your information, that's what your CME, your chief marketing evangelist, is going to do for you, is explain to you how to organize your information so that you get the highest price point. So, Narissa's article, When Did Wheat Become a Bad Guy? That's another either standalone book or a multi-authored book contribution. And then the last item or ad on this page is SueCastle.com, which is providing or selling these far infrared negative ion amethyst crystal beds or mats. They're biomats that you put under your bed or under your top sheet or your mattress covers. So this is interesting. So this is a Kindle book here, and it's already got the table of contents. The entire contents of the book is already listed here. So how to reverse your discomfort smooth and easy or something, you know, like that. So the table of contents is how to improve circulation, how to improve cardiovascular function, how to improve immune function, how to relieve pain, how to ease joint and stiffness pain. Or another item that she doesn't have in here is how to regenerate. The reason people have joint pain is either the synovial fluid, the liquid joint material that's in between the ball and socket of their joint, is deteriorating, or their ball and socket have fractured, so there's a sharp edge. So what we do with our clients, which again only usually takes a few weeks, is we help them regenerate their synovial fluid. So if you think about a ball and joint, it's riding on synovial fluid, which is a liquid tissue membrane that provides the slickness or the lubrication for a ball to move inside a joint. Now, if that synovial fluid becomes thin or dehydrated or absent, then it's bone on bone, and eventually that's going to wear down the bones and create a lot of pain around the nerve endings inside the synovial fluid as it breaks down, and then external to the joint and ball. As the synovial fluid is completely destroyed and the joint begins to become lopsided, in other words, it doesn't rotate inside its correct perimeter. In other words, if you rotate a joint or a socket or a ball inside a socket long enough, eventually you'll wear it down and that socket will start, or the ball will start slipping outside the socket, which is very painful. So what we do is we, you know, regenerate the synovial fluid. And I'd probably say in 80 to 90%, eight or nine out of 10 people, that's really the best way. That typically resolves all their discomfort. A few people will have to go down another road, but that's another topic to put in the book here. Let's see, improve skin, burn calories, control weight, reduce stress and fatigue, remove toxins, FDA approved medical device, and it's got the looks like the FDA approval number here. So, you know, this is a whole book here. And one of the things she can sell is biomats, and she can also sell, either sell other people's lines of products to be adjuncts or add-ons to facilitate or accelerate the function of biomats, or create her own brands, kind of like the Herbs and Things shop did, or the way we did with Radical Health. We created a brand called Sunfire Superfoods. So anyway, I'm just looking through. I mean, I'm glancing through a few other pages here, and they're basically the whole thing's the same thing. I mean, you create the butter churn model of your business, where you have a Kindle book that you either do yourself and take the minor income off that, and maybe that's enough to make you happy, or you roll it over to a publisher. They keep all that and drive all the traffic to your website. And then you have a CME that helps you work on your website to have that next layer of I guess it would be, you got the milk is Kindle, the butter would be The next level, which would be your incoming products, your courses, like in the, you know, the less than $100 price range. And then the cream at the top is your one-on-one consulting, or it could be group workshops or whatever. In other words, that's a higher dollar income. And so your CME will help you design that, and you'll either have to put them on salary, or a lot of times, like what I do, is I'll work with people, only people that have got a viable business that, you know, meets my frequency. In other words, I wouldn't help people, for example, do site about how to make your own sausage at home, because I'm a vegan. So that's a dissonant frequency with me. I wouldn't do a site about, you know, how to learn to be a pole dancing stripper, because that's out of frequency with me. If you've got a site that, like, you know, like the Food Powers, like Narissa's site, or maybe Sue Castle's site, those sort of are resonant frequencies with me. And so those would be activities where I could see myself being a CME. And so what I would do on that basis is a person would pay an initial flat rate fee to do a consulting interaction, and then I would tool their website for them for usually a 50-50 split of that product, which is usually a lot better than a publisher, because usually in the publishing model, the publishers keep like 80 or 90%. And then the practitioner would keep 100% of their high-end income, of their one-on-one consulting or their group workshops, because those were situations that I had nothing to do with. That's, you know, if a person is doing all the work, they should get all the money. So anyway, that's a walkthrough of Austin All Natural, February 13, pages 16 through 19, of doing different business models using the marketing churn business model.